All right. So today we are going to start talking about Gauss's law. This is chapter 22 in your book. These are the reading assignments and these are the suggested problems. First, I want to introduce some preliminary concepts for us to be able to talk about Gauss's law. So the first thing is electric flux, and given some electric field like this, let's say I have a uniform electric field and I want to define a surface area. I could define it the way I want, but here in this figure, the surface is defined like this, right? And for this configuration, I would like to define something called flux. And we generally show flux with some uppercase phi, Greek letter phi, is equal to the electric field, or maybe we can talk about the perpendicular component of electric field with respect to plane normal, or perpendicular component of the surface with respect to electric field multiplied together, right? E perp dot A, or E times A perp. But this whole thing can be written like electric field times area, whatever the area is, times cosine theta. So we generally, okay, cosine, we know cosine comes from dot product. And for this, we introduce a dot product like this. First vector is electric field. The second vector, we prepare another vector from the area. So it's the magnitude of area times a normal vector on this area. And we call this area vector. And this is the flux, E dot E. And the unit of flux is electric field is Newton per Coulomb, area is meter squared. So flux is not surprisingly Newton per Coulomb times meter squared. So this whole thing was for like a simple uniform electric field with like a flat surface. But if you don't have uniform electric field or like a flat surface, we can divide this surface into smaller and smaller pieces. For example, like this. Here, neither the electric field nor the surface is uniform, but we can take tiny little bit of square on the surface. And this square is so tiny, the electric field, all the electric field going through it is almost uniform and area is almost flat. So we can calculate the flux for this little square like this. It's like phi for this little square, area is, let's call it delta AI, and the electric field there is, let's call this EI. And if you sum over all these little squares like this, one by one, we have the total flux. And we know what this is. This is the integral. And this is basically dA, all little areas multiplied with electric field that could depend on the position on the area and integrated overall. Generally, we will be talking about closed surfaces. So this one is, for example, at least for this example, it's open. This one seems to be open, but we could have something like a closed surface like this. Like this, there is like a shell, kind of like a shell that encloses a finite volume in this space. In this case, we'll represent this kind of flux with this different integral sign, like integral sign, and there's like a circle on it. And this circle indicates it's like a closed surface. And the flux is calculated for this closed surface because we can calculate electric field at any point on the surface and the area vector on any point on the surface. So here is the convention. Now when we have a closed surface, we have to introduce a convention for the area vector. And the convention is that the normal is generally pointing out of a closed surface, right? For example, for this guy, I know this is a closed surface and there is a sense of inside and outside when I look at the surface. So I define the normal vector like this, everywhere outside. Or if you are looking here, maybe it's like this, this. It always points from inside to outside. Okay. So if I have this convention, there is something interesting. So if there is like an incoming electric field, for example, let's look at this figure more closely. So this is like, let's focus on one electric field line like this. And now let's look at the incoming electric field. Since we use a convention that A points out, this is the area vector dotted with this kind of electric field. You can kind of see that this angle is bigger than pi over 2. So this whole dot product will be negative. So whereas in this one, electric field points kind of like this, and area vector points like this. And you can kind of judge for yourself that the angle between these two will be less than pi over 2. So the flux will be positive. So there is a reason for this. And the reason is we generally consider incoming flux negative and outgoing flux positive. Okay, that's the convention. So if electric fields, if you are in a flux, for example, we can kind of see everything that comes in. Okay, if something comes in from here, something comes out from here. Something comes in from here, something comes out from here. So whatever comes in eventually comes out, right? That's the nice thing about flux. Every external flux enters from a certain region and exits from a certain region. So number of lines in should be equal to number of lines. But in some cases, like for example, here you can kind of judge for yourself that the total flux will be zero because every in has like an out, right? Or like if you have a closed surface, whatever comes in, will come out. In flux is negative, out flux is positive. So they will add up to give you zero. And this kind of observation happens only if there is no charge inside. And the idea is like this. Suppose you have a charge inside like this. Let's call this Q. That means it could be positive or negative. Some electric field lines, like we talked in the previous weeks, some electric field lines either will emerge from the charge like this, if this is a positive charge, or it is going to terminate at this charge. Let's call this negative. If it's negative, it's going to be like this. So you can see if you extend this, this line only enters and it terminates at the charge. So it doesn't continue and exit. There's another line that just terminates at the charge, but it just enters into the surface. Or maybe I can look at a positive charge. In the case of a positive charge, lines emerge like this, or maybe like this. I don't know, maybe like this, like this. So you can see the lines from the charge only exit the surface. There's no corresponding entering line. So in this case, you can see the total flux coming from this single charge will be non-zero over the surface because they only exit. So the upshot is the total flux in a surface is non-zero only if there exists a charge inside this enclosed surface. So now is the Gauss's law. Gauss's law says that the flux in an enclosed region, which is what we show like this, is equal to total charge in that enclosed region, whatever it is, it could be positive or negative, divided by this constant epsilon naught. Okay. If you have a charge like, say, like this, and if you enclose this charge with some volume, it could be like this, maybe like this. You can enclose it with volume or like this. And if you calculate the total flux in either of these volumes, like this one or this one, and sum over all surface, you will find it's equal to this nice quantity, total charge divided by epsilon naught. Now, Gauss's law is identical to Coulomb's law. Actually, it's another way of stating the Coulomb's law. And we can see this from the following observation. So we consider a sphere and we calculate the total flux in a sphere. Let's say it's this sphere, or like, I think that we have multiple spheres on this page. Let's say it's this sphere, and I wanted to calculate total flux in the sphere, right? And I need to multiply it with electric field. And according to Gauss's law, it should be Q over epsilon naught. But I can calculate this left-hand side for a perfect sphere. It's basically, the electric field is uniform on the sphere. So I can just take it out of integral, and the total area is going to be what? It's going to be the area of sphere. And we know what it is. It's like 4 pi r squared. So electric field times 4 pi r squared should be equal to Q over epsilon naught. Then I can solve this equation for electric field, which will give me the Coulomb's law. E is equal to 4 over 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q over r squared. So we could use this logic in the reverse direction. We could also say that we can derive Gauss's law from the Coulomb's law using the same integral. Now, let's say we want to consider this kind of surface, the blue surface, and I want to calculate the total flux. Let's call this A2 integral dA times E. But I know any flux on the surface should be equivalent to any other surface like this, because anything that comes from here goes through this surface too. If you look carefully, like anything that goes through this surface, whatever it is, also goes through this other surface, right? So the flux through this surface and this surface, the blue, the green surface and the blue surface should be identical. So I write this, so the first blue surface flux and now the green surface flux, let's call this A1. But now I know how to calculate A1 because electric field over this A1 surface is constant. It's like equal distance from the charge. And the surface is, I know the surface of a sphere, it's like 4 pi r squared. So I can just put everything in the, like it's like surface area, electric field is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times Q over r squared from Coulomb's law. And if I do the simplification, I'll find that this whole thing is equal to total charge divided by epsilon naught. Here is the example from your book, flux from Gauss's law. Consider two Gaussian surfaces, A1 and A2, like this and this, as shown in this figure. And the only charge present is the charge Q at the center of surface A1, this charge. What is the net flux through each surface, A1 and A2? So the Gauss law says net flux is equal to total charge inside. So for the first guy, we know this one is net flux is equal to the charge is plus Q divided by epsilon naught. And for the second one, I can see some electric field lines enter from here, but whatever enters also exits. So every in, there's an out. And I look at the figure and I see no charge. So Gauss law says phi is equal to zero in this case. Okay. So this was like two spheres and only one of the spheres has a charge. Another exercise from your book is says that suppose you have a point charge Q and at the center of a spherical Gaussian surface. When a second charge Q is placed just outside A, the total flux through this spherical surface A, let me ask you, let's say I have this surface and I have this Q, okay, there is some flux, phi, and now let's call this Q1, and now I put a second Q2. Of course, this charge will have its own electric field. There'll be some coming in, something like that. And the question is total flux through this surface, does it increase, decrease, or stay the same? Unchanged, right? Yes. Basically, this charge outside does not affect the total flux on the surface because of Gauss's law. Total flux only is coming from total charge inside. All right. Let's continue. Here's the example. Like, let's solve a problem to exercise. And this is the example from your book. A thin spherical shell of radius R naught possesses a total net charge Q. So this is a spherical conductor, and there is like a total charge Q that is uniformly distributed. Determine the electric field at points A outside the shell, B inside the shell, and C, what if the conductor were a solid sphere? What would change in C? Okay, let me go ahead and start. So first, let's start with A, outside. A. So I form a Gaussian surface, and if I'm outside, I can form this surface. Let's call this A1. And the Gauss's law says total flux on A1 is equal to Q over epsilon naught. I know the electric field on this green surface is constant. So this one, wherever I go, I have the same electric field. So I can simplify this as like E, and I can now take the integral, which is 4 pi r squared should be equal to Q over epsilon naught. Then E will be 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q over r squared. So B inside. So now I can form a Gaussian surface like this, A2. So A2 dA dot E is equal to Q over epsilon naught. But I know there is no charge inside, right? This is like an empty hollow spherical shell. So if total charge is zero, then total flux is zero. And the electric field in this case should be zero with the same logic here. Okay, it's constant on all surface and the surface P 4 pi r squared, but if the charge is zero, E should be zero. Now C, So what about a solid sphere? Maybe I can ask you. If you had like a solid metallic sphere like this filled, what would change? What would be different? Suppose I have a metallic sphere and it's filled. So it's not shell now, right? And I put a charge on this guy, Q. And where does this charge go? So we know in conductors, charge is free to move, right? Yes, exactly. And if you put a charge, this charge can only go to the surface. So, however much charge you put on the sphere, it's going to be on the surface, exactly like this shell. So, if you take a Gaussian surface inside, actually, total charge enclosed is zero. So, E inside is still zero. And E outside, we can do direct exactly what we did here. So it's going to be exactly the same, 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q over r squared. Okay. This is another way of seeing that electric field inside metals or good conductors should be zero. So Gauss's law immediately gives us that result. So this is another example. Now let's consider a solid sphere, but this time it's not a conductor so that there's like a charge inside too. And the charge is distributed uniformly throughout the non-conducting sphere of radius r naught. Here our task is to determine the electric field outside r bigger than r naught and inside the sphere. Okay, maybe I can go ahead and start. A, so R, maybe I can start with outside because that's what R bigger than R naught. So I can again use the Gauss's law. Let's draw a surface, A1. Let's call this A1. I could draw anyone, but I just draw a sample surface outside. And I want to call this the A dot E. Again, this is like a spherically symmetric problem. So I can take E outside the integral and take the surface integral, but the surface integral is going to give me what? Again, exactly the same story, 4 pi r squared times E. And this should be equal to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. So from this, E is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times Q over r squared. So outside of a metal ball is not different whether the ball is metallic or insulated or like non-conducting or conducting. So let's do B. Now R less than, so it's like all charges collected in the center. So here it's not in the center. It's like uniform. Wherever you look, you have the same amount of charge. It doesn't change. That's the name, that's the meaning of uniform electric charge. Yes, outside it behaves the same, outside. Now let's look at inside. Let's look inside. R is equal to R naught. Now I want to choose this surface inside. Let's call this A2. This is a radius, a surface with radius less than R naught. So let's call this A2 dA times E is equal to. Now again, this surface is chosen spherically symmetric, so electric field should be constant on every point on the surface. So I can take it outside the integral and take this integral, the same trick. So this is going to be 4 pi r squared times e, but on the right hand side, I need to calculate the total charge enclosed in this region. And I can calculate that it is basically volume times charge density. Charge density, okay, maybe I can write it like charge density times volume divided by epsilon naught. But this is equal to what? Charge density is total charge divided by 4 over 3 pi r cube, which is the volume of this little sphere. Or sorry, I'm trying to find the charge density. So it's the volume of whole sphere, like total charge divided by total volume. So let's call this r naught. And I need to multiply it with volume I have at my hand, which is this one. So it's going to be 4 over 3 pi r cube. And I multiply this whole thing with epsilon naught. So I can clean these factors, clean this. So also here I have r squared, I have r cubed. So the total result is something like this. E is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q, maybe I can write it like this, q over r zero cube times r, right? So let me count, there's like r left, r zero cube, and that's it, right? And then now let's plot this and see how it changes. So that's one axis. That's the other axis. This is E. This is R. And I have a special R, which is R0. Let's call this like this. So initially, it seems to be increasing linearly with R. So let's write this like linear. I don't know, maybe something like this. And once it hits the surface here, it seems to be decreasing like quadratically as usual. So it's going to be like this. Right. And this point is equal to 1 over 4 pi q over r0 squared. Okay. Whereas like I remind you, whereas in the metallic case, let's draw the metallic case with green. So outside, I said it's exactly the same. So metallic case is going to be something like this, right? So this is metal or conductor case. Conducting sphere. How about inside? So I said in the metallic case, I have this green line, zero, right? Then I need to jump like this here and go to zero like this. So that's the difference. And that's a big difference you can see inside. Whereas in the non-conducting case, you have this. In the metallic case, you have zero electric field inside. So now let's do another example. Now I want to look at a different geometry. Now we have like this, our favorite long line of uniform charge. Let's call this line to go from infinity to minus infinity to plus infinity, right? So step one, we choose a surface. And generally electric field along this surface we choose should be zero, should be constant so that we can take this integral. And when it is constant, I can take E outside and now I calculate area. So it's like a constant E times 4 pi r squared, which is area. And it should be equal to total charge inside divided by epsilon naught. And this gives me the electric field. I think this is always, I mean, in rare, except rare cases, this is going to be always the case for you to solve. So let's do another example. Here is the problem. So this line goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, and it has a uniform positive charge per unit length. Let's call this lambda. And we want to calculate the electric field at points near but outside the wire, far from the ends. So like I said, okay, maybe I can just solve it. So like I said, the idea is the same. Choose a Gaussian surface in which the electric field is constant. So for this wire, I know electric field is radially out because of symmetry, right? If you look at the wire, there is like symmetry reason that electric field like should be like this at every point. And I think we discussed this at length last week. Then I can choose a Gaussian surface that suits that kind of electric field. And for that, I choose a cylindrical Gaussian surface. Okay. And now I look at these like sides of this cylinder. Like maybe I can show it with this. This R, this red, and this red. What is the net flux through these like red regions? What is the flux? Zero, right? Because there is no electric field line that's coming in or going out the same, because electric field is always tangential to that surface. So the flux here is also zero. Then I can calculate the flux that remains on the rest or around here. So let's calculate this. So let's call this, I don't know, some surface A, dA dot E. So along this surface, again, electric field is constant. So I take it out. It's going to be E times area of surface, which is what? Area of outside area of cylinder. It's like 2 pi R times its length. And this should be equal to Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. But I can calculate how much charge I have inside. It says uniform charge density. It should be equal to some L times lambda divided by epsilon naught. Now I can simplify. L goes, and I can solve it for E. E is equal to E is equal to 1 over 2 pi epsilon naught lambda over R, which should be the case, right? We also found the same result with some elaborate integral last week. Okay, let's do one more example. Now, the other example we had last week was like an infinite plane. Now, let's do the infinite plane case. Now, surface charge density in the infinite plane is given by sigma. And we want to find electric field outside the surface. So why? Exactly, right? So yes, that's true. Gauss's law makes a lot of things easy for us, right? But I think the style chosen for this class is like, first, learn some painful integrals and then use Gauss's law. Then you will understand the value of Gauss's law, right? I think I could as well introduce this in the first week. And I'm pretty sure everybody would say like, oh, this is like kindergarten, but nobody would know the value of this law. And actually, as simple as its application, it's actually a very deep concept, right? It's like a very fundamental law in physics. It's a good comment. You're absolutely right. But this thing, like not showing it in first, It is not accident. It's done on purpose. Okay, let's do this example. So here's how it works. So again, we have a surface. Let's say the surface goes to infinity, right? And we want to calculate the electric field outside the surface. And the surface charge density is sigma. Again, I have to choose a Gaussian surface that suits the problem. For this, I choose a disk, like a cylindrical surface, that goes in from one side and is symmetric on the other side. Like if you look at the surface, it's kind of like this. Maybe I can choose the green. Okay. Something like this. And the electric field is pointing out. We know from symmetry that should be the case. Now let's use the Gauss's law again. In the surface, let's call this A dA dot E is equal to. And now the question is, what is the net flux through these side surfaces? Like sides of this cylinder. It's zero, exactly. So then I only need to calculate the flux through this surface and this other surface. Let me do this. I know it is out in both cases, out here. So I can do E dot A plus E dot A. And this should be equal to Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. But Q enclosed is what? Sigma times area, like areal density times area will give you the charge is equal to so naught. You can kind of see this A will go with this A. And then this side will give you 2E is equal to sigma over epsilon naught. Then E is equal to sigma over 2 epsilon naught. Right? The same law. We don't have to deal with some nasty integrals, which is nice. So let's do this another example. Here, this is example 8 from your book. Electric field near any conducting surface. And we, our task is to show that the electric field just outside the surface of any good conductor of arbitrary shape is given by this. E is equal to sigma over epsilon naught, where sigma is the surface charge density on the conductor surface at that point. So the key word here is electric field near the conducting surface. And here the problem is also repeating this, electric field just outside the surface. It's not like if this is surface and if you are far away from surface, that's not the problem is asking. Problem is asking right over here. Okay. Now we can do the same trick. If we are close enough to the surface, this surface is almost flat. Like it's of course two-dimensional surface in a three-dimensional geometry, but we are looking at the cross section. And if you are close enough to the surface, electric field is constant because it's like a flat. Now I can choose a Gaussian surface like this green box, which may have like, I don't know, again, a circular cross section. Or if you like, you can also do like a square cross section, nothing changes. But let's choose this circular cross section. Maybe I can do this. There is one here, there is one here, right? Now the question is, this surface is inside the conductor and this surface is outside the conductor. And maybe I should ask you, what is the electric field insight here. This guy, what is the electric field? Zero, exactly, right? So this one, E is equal to zero, then flux should be zero. So on the sides, I think we don't have any problem. Sides, we already all agreed that sides flux is zero because it's parallel to the electric field lines. So sides phi is zero. So what only remains is like this outside circular region, just one single surface. And I write this, and let's use the Gauss's law. So this is, okay, let me use less obnoxious color. So this is E dA times E. There's only one surface, and it's like, let's call it some electric field times area, and area, let's call this a disk, 2 pi r squared should be equal to charge inside is, okay, sigma times, I don't know, 2 pi r squared divided by epsilon naught. So you can cancel these, and the result is E is equal to sigma over epsilon naught. I choose a circle, but I think you could choose any area. Here I chose a circular cross section, like a disk. Oops. Here I choose like this cross section. It could be anything. You could choose, you can just call it A because it doesn't matter, right? Some area. You can choose some weird area because it's constant anyways. Inside is zero, yes. Inside, electric field is zero. So whatever the area is, electric field is zero, so flux is zero. All the flux is on the outside surface here. Part that you should be careful is the following. If you had like a non-conducting surface like this, for example, in this case, you had electric field on both sides. So there was like EA time plus EA. But in the conducting case, electric field was allowed only on one side if you are close to surface. So we only had E times A. We didn't have the second E. Maybe I can just choose this A. So this is A. This is A. And these A's cancel. So here there were like two surfaces. Here in the metallic case, we have single surface. And we have to be careful with this, right? I think there is like, maybe I can tell you to consider like, what if, maybe it's a homework for you. What if this guy was a metallic surface with finite width with the same charge density, right? Sigma per area. What would change? Maybe you can calculate that for yourself. So let's talk about this electric field inside conductors, which we already talked like last week, I think, a little bit more considering the Gauss's law. And our like key result or like key postulate was that in static equilibrium, the electric field inside the conductors is zero. And our argument was like this. Inside conductors, like if you choose a chunk of metal, and if you, of course, you have like free charges here. These charges were free to move. That was the definition of a conductor. And if you had any electric field inside, these charges would move, right? Because there was like a net force on them. And that would not be the static equilibrium. So this is what we had last week. Now let's just think about the same thing from a Gauss's law perspective. Like, let's think about this piece of metal like this. And let's say there is like a charge on this piece of metal. And we know the charge is going to be in the outer surface, right here, right? Right here. Whatever the charge is, it's going to be in the outer surface. Now we can choose a Gaussian surface, which is right inside, right? Could be anywhere, but inside. So if this is the surface, I'm just taking just a little bit inside. This green line. So this green line doesn't enclose any points on the surface. Then I know the Gauss's law. Gauss's law says total flux in this region should be equal to charge inside, but charge inside is zero. So that immediately implies total electric field on the surface should be zero, right? And total flux through this surface should be zero. So that's something we already know. So I just state this from the Gauss's law perspective. Now let's do some experiments here. Let's imagine we are putting a hole here, like here. Let's put a hole here. And now there is still a charge Q on this metal, but there is like a hole inside. And this is like an empty cavity. There's nothing. And I want to ask, if you have like a Gaussian surface like this, what is the net flux, right? It's basically zero because there is no charge inside. And the electric field along these lines is zero because electric field in metals is zero. Okay, that's also simple stuff. And now let's put a charge here, right? Let's put a charge here. Let's call this point charge plus Q. And I want to ask the following. So electric field inside metals should still be zero in static equilibrium. So if I enclose this hollow region with the charge, with some Gaussian surface like this, so I should get what? I should get total electric, so total flux through this surface should be zero, right? Because at any point on this green surface, electric field is zero, so the flux is zero. That means total charge inside this green region is zero. But that means I already have like a plus Q charge here, then that means I should have exactly minus Q charge on the surface, this hollow region surface. Like here is, maybe I can just show it like this charge is exactly minus Q. So the total charge inside this green region is zero. So that total electric field inside the metal is zero. But if the total conductor is neutral, there must be equal and opposite amount of charge with the opposite sign on the outer surface, right? All the charge that accumulates here will give rise to an opposite charge on the outer surface. Now, the nice thing is if you take like an outer Gaussian surface like this, whatever happens with this metal is going to be exactly like a charge in the middle and no metal, because Gauss's law says the flux on this surface is only determined by the total charge inside, and total charge inside is plus Q because this metal is overall neutral, right? So the upshot is, you know, this metal, whatever it does, the total flux outside is flux of charge and inside electric field is zero. So here's like, I think I already discussed this, but let's go through this conceptual example one more time to reiterate. So suppose a conductor carries a net charge Q and contains a cavity inside of which resides a point charge Q. Okay. So the question is, what can you say about the charges on the inner and outer surfaces of the conductor? Now it's like exactly like this. There is like an overall charge on Q. Maybe I can say this is Q, and I want to put like a charge inside, plus Q. And what can you say about the charges on the inner and outer surfaces? So maybe I can start with inner surface. What is the charge on the inner surface here? So this is like a plus Q inside. So the outer surface should be what? Minus Q, exactly. So it is minus Q, so that when you have like a Gaussian surface like this inside the metal, it is zero because electric field is zero at any point. And now if minus Q is here, total charge should be plus Q. So this charge plus this minus Q should be Q. So the surface charge, the amount of charge on the surface is going to be Q plus Q, because this metal was initially charged with total charge Q, right? And if you like, this one was the case in which this capital Q was zero. Is that clear? So this is what I can say about the total charges on inner surface and outer surface. Inner surface is minus Q, other surface is Q plus Q. Okay? I think that's it for today. Maybe we can start with like suggested problems. Here's the first one. I can clean this. So in a certain region of space, the electric field is constant in direction like this. The direction is constant. Let's say horizontal in x direction, but its magnitude decreases from E is equal to some number at x is equal to zero to E is equal to some other number like 410 Newton per Coulomb at x is equal to 25 meters. And our task is to determine the charge within a cubical box of side L, where the box is oriented so that four of its sides are parallel to the field lines, like one, two, there's one at the bottom and on the other side. They're all parallel. And so there's some electric field in, some out, and we want to determine the charge inside. Maybe I can go ahead and solve. I think it's like, so Gauss's law says, okay, maybe I can do this. Phi inside, or maybe I can say like this, flux on the surface is equal to Q inside divided by epsilon naught. Now flux on these surfaces are zero because electric field is parallel. Lines do not come in or get out from these surfaces. So then I only need to calculate this and this surface. I know this one is positive because normal is like this, right? And I can do this. It's like E 2 times area, and area is, let's call this A. And this one is negative because normal is like this, but this one is entering. So let's call this minus E1 times E, the same. And we want to find what Q inside is. So here E2 is given, E1 is given, area is known, so we can calculate Q inside. So Q is equal to epsilon naught E2 minus E1 times area. Let's put the numbers. It's 8885. So this is epsilon naught, I just copied from your book, times 10 to the minus 12. Coulomb squared divided by Newton meter squared times E2 minus E1, 410 minus 560, and this is Newton per Coulomb, times 25 times 25 meter squared. Let's check the units. Meter squared, Coulomb, Coulomb, Newton, Newton. So the overall unit is Coulomb, as it should be. And we can multiply all these numbers. This is 8.3. This is 8.3. So, okay, the problem is problem 30, but it was dependent on 29. So I copied both of them. Suppose in this figure, there is a charge Q at the center of cavity here. And there's like a cavity, like a spherical cavity of radius R1. And there's like a second radius like this. And this region is uniformly charged and total charge is Q. And we would like to determine the electric field for A inside the cavity, like here in this region, B inside the shell around this region, and C outside the cavity, outside the whole thing. And this is, the key is, this is a non-conducting sphere. Basically, a non-conducting sphere has a spherical cavity of radius R1, centered at the sphere's center. And we assume that the charge Q is distributed uniformly in the shell here. And there is an later and overall, like there's this point charge Q at the center here. And we'd like to determine the electric field here inside the cavity, inside the shell and outside the shell. Okay, let's do this. Okay, first A. We can choose like any Gaussian surface, but I'm going to choose something like this. This blue surface, and it encloses only the charge. But let's write dA times E is equal to total charge inside is Q divided by epsilon naught. But the integral is simple. It's because electric field is constant, E times area 4 pi r squared. Then from here, electric field inside is, as it should be, 4 pi epsilon naught. This is Q. Okay. Oops. This is Q divided by R squared. Simple Coulomb's law. And now let's talk about B. Now I choose a Gaussian surface. Let me clean the first one. I choose a Gaussian surface inside. Again, this is a perfect sphere. And this radius is some R. So, and I can, for the flux, I can do the same argument, right? This is dA times E. Electric field on the surface is constant, so electric field goes outside the integral. And integral now is simple, 4 pi R squared. But now I need to calculate the enclosed charge. I already have a Q here, so let me write first Q. Plus, and the uniform charge density times volume of this region divided by epsilon naught. Okay, any questions for this? So let's calculate this rho times V on the side. So rho times V is equal to what? So the rho is total charge, which is Q divided by 4 over 3 pi, like total volume of this guy, which is, so this is r0 cube minus r1 cube. And if I multiply with 4 over 3 pi r cube minus r1 cube. So these 4 pi's cancel. So I can put this back in. So what do I get? What I get is E is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. And here I have Q plus Q times R cube minus R1 cube divided by R0 cube minus R1 cube, and this whole thing divided by, let me just push it a little bit, this whole thing divided by R squared. Okay, this is inside. Is there a charge in question 29? In question 29, there is no charge, but we are trying to solve 30 in which there is like a charge here. Okay. And the answer is there is like an electric field coming from this point charge, as if there is nothing, right? This is exactly that. And there is an electric field coming from that charge density region, which is like that. A little bit more complicated, but that's fine. And let's do C. Again, now I choose a Gaussian surface outside. Something like that. And now my radius is here. I can do the same trick. Now E times 4 pi r squared is equal to inside Q plus Q divided by epsilon naught. Then electric field outside is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q plus Q divided by r squared. Now exactly the same thing, but now it's like a cylindrical version of the previous problem. A very long, solid, non-conducting cylinder of radius R1 is uniformly charged with a charge density rho of E. And it is surrounded by a concentric cylindrical tube of inner radius R2 and outer radius R3 as shown here. And it is also carrying a uniform charge density rho of E. And you'd like to determine the electric field as a function of distance r from the center of the cylinder for inside the first one, like here, inside the hollow region here, inside the second cylinder here, and the outside. And it's saying that if rho of E is this and R1 is equal to R2 is equal to this, plot E as a function of R from R is equal to zero to some, and assume the cylinders are very long compared to R3. So I plotted the intersection here because it's what matters. Like there's one cylinder, there's like a hollow region, and there's another cylinder, and this is the empty space. Okay. And now in each case, I want to take a cylindrical Gaussian surface like this, some circular cross section, and if some, let's say, finite height h like this. And I will take one surface inside here, another surface inside here, another surface inside here, and another surface inside here. In total, I have to take 1, 2, 3, 4 different Gaussian surfaces for four different cases A, B, C, and D. So let's start with the first one. Okay, this is like what? dA times E is equal to Q inside divided by epsilon naught. E is constant and area is 2 pi r times h. This should be equal to total charge inside is some rho e times volume, which is pi r squared times h, and divide this by epsilon naught. Can simplify, okay, pi. So h doesn't depend on h, radius r. So what remains is only r. So let's just write this. So e is equal to rho e over 2 epsilon naught times r. So some linear electric field in radius. So this is A. So let's do B similarly. Now for B, we are going to do the same thing, but the surface is like now here. Let's take that. E times 2 pi r times h is equal to, but now inside is rho e times pi times r1 squared times h divided by epsilon naught. Again, cancel this, this, this with this. Now you can tell E is equal to rho e r1 squared divided by 2 epsilon naught times 1 over r. Yes, right now I did this one. Now I'm going to do this one, the third one. A, B, let's call this C. So again, E times 2 pi R times H. You can tell in every case, left-hand side is the same. Only I just do some work to calculate charge inside. This is equal to, again, this is rho E times pi R1 squared times H plus the other one also carries the same charge density, right? Let's see. And it too carries a uniform charge density, rho E. Both of them has the same charge density, which is nice. So let's call this rho E times pi. Okay, I need to do something like this. Pi R squared. Rho E times pi R squared minus pi R2 squared times H. This is the total charge divided by epsilon naught. Again, I can cancel H, H, H. I can cancel pi, 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 pi. So you can tell. So this whole thing is going to be what? Maybe I can simplify. So this is rho E R1 squared minus R2 squared plus R2 squared. So E is equal to divided by this 2 epsilon 0 R. So the key is, okay, there is some R squared here, there's some R here, total should be something like a linear increase. And the last one, A, B, C, D, again, E times 2 pi R times H should be equal to rho E times pi R1 squared plus rho E times pi R3 squared minus R2 squared. And this whole thing is multiplied with H. divided by epsilon naught, then E is going to be what? Okay, maybe I can shift everything a little bit. I just need one more line. Okay. E is equal to rho E times R1 squared minus R2 squared plus R3 squared divided by 2 epsilon naught times 1 over R. So basically, I canceled these, I canceled pi's, and I had an overall 1 over r. So if you plot this, let's plot this guy and see how it changes. Of course, there are like radiuses. There's like r1 here. There is, I don't know, R2 here, and there is, maybe I can do a little bit, squeeze these. Okay. Let's call this R1. Let's call this R2. Let's call this R1, R2, R3. So the first one, I look and see it increases linearly. So it's something like this. So when it reaches the surface of the first cylinder here, it starts to decrease with 1 over r. Let's do that. So it's decreasing with some 1 over r here. And then here, in the third case, overall it seems like something like almost like linear. I would say it's like something like that. Maybe like that, I don't know. Should be probably more, maybe like this. And then it decreases again with 1 over r in the last part, okay? And this is electric field as a function of radius. So on the left-hand side, in each case, I have a cylindrical surface, a cylinder in each case, right? And the electric field on these sides were zero, so I only needed to calculate the area of the cylinder in this curved surface here. So it's like 2 pi r, okay. If you have like a cylinder, this area here is, okay, maybe I can draw it like here. If you have a cylinder like this, so this area here, so this outer surface area is 2 pi r, if there's like a radius, and its height is h, 2 pi r times h. So in each case, I have 2 pi r times h, 2 pi r times h, 2 pi r times h, and the only difference was radius was this, 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 or this, okay? But on the right-hand side, here, I calculated the total charge, and total charge was volume times the volume charge density. In C, E is decreasing exponentially due to rho, but increasing linearly due to outer shell. How is it supposed to increase linearly? So this is the R, this is total, right? I think this is probably a little bit more complex than this, but you can calculate this whole thing and see it for yourself, because I didn't want to sit down and, you know, I think you should put these numbers and this number and plot it exactly, but I said it should be something like this. I don't know, maybe just weak. It could be a little bit weak quadratic, but it doesn't matter. It should be something like that. So increase, decrease, something like that. So like, yeah, that's it, right? On the left hand side you calculate the surface, on the right hand side you calculate the volume, and then you take care of pi's and h's, and everything cancels nicely if you don't miss anything. So a very large thin plane has uniform surface charge density sigma, and touching on it is on the right like this. Okay, this is some surface with charge density sigma, and touching on it to the right is a long white slab. That's a slab. And we are looking at the cross section, and the thickness is D with uniform volume charge density rho E. Okay. And we want to determine the electric field to the left of the plane, to the right of the slab, and everywhere inside the slab. So we want to determine here, here, and here, okay? And with the sequence, like, so region A to the left of the plane, to the right of the slab, this is B, and everywhere inside the slab, this is C. So for A, I can do this, right? Okay, I don't know. I can choose a Gaussian surface like this. So I know everything, like I know what should be first. Okay, let's simplify it a little bit for us. I know electric field should be like this, right? No matter what, it is like this. So my surface, my Gaussian surface should respect that symmetry. And for that, I choose something like that. Okay. And this has an area here. And now, okay, let's start with case A. It's going to be E times A plus. Okay, let me choose another color. E times A plus E times A should be equal to total charge inside. One is sigma times A, and the other one is rho E times D times A divided by epsilon naught. I can cancel these. And E is equal to sigma plus rho E times D divided by 2 epsilon naught, right? So B, I think it's going to be the same. So it's also E is equal to sigma times sigma plus rho E times D divided by 2 epsilon naught. And now I need to choose a surface for inside, right? And let's look at the last one. I think the first two was easy because electric field here and here should be the same. But now the point is, let's choose a surface like that here. Okay. So now this E, I already determined. This is known, but this, I don't know, E inside, let's call this E outside. Let's call this outside, 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 outside. E inside is not known. Let's calculate this. So what I would do is, like, let's call it C flux E outside times A, right? And here I assume it's this way plus E inside times A is equal to some sigma times A. This is the charge coming from the surface. Now I need to calculate charge coming from this volume, which should be rho of E. Let's call this, I don't know. Let's call this distance X. Rho E times volume is area, area times X divided by epsilon naught. So first let's cancel these A's. And the second, let's put this E naught we actually found from here. Okay. then E inside is equal to sigma plus rho E times X divided by epsilon naught minus E naught is sigma plus rho E times D divided by 2 epsilon naught. And this whole thing should be equal to, I think these guys seem to cancel. And it should be something like that. Rho E X minus D divided by epsilon naught. So this is E inside. Okay, that's it. So this one, I see. So then I think it's going to be something like that. Good job. Thank you. So this is 2. And this is 2 sigma. This is 2 sigma. And something like this. Let me fix this real quick. So now I see your point. So this is 2 sigma minus sigma is going to give us sigma. Sigma and plus rho E times 2x minus D. And this should be divided by 2 epsilon naught. Good, right? How about this one? So I said, okay, if you choose a Gaussian surface like this, I know if this is like a plane, electric field is like forget about slab. If it's only like a surface, we know the result, right? E and E here, or like if you are outside, E and E constant. And I can think of slab as like infinitely many thin sheets, and each of them will contribute the same to the here, to the right, to the left. So by looking at this and that, I can say electric field here and here should be the same. I don't have any reason for them to be different. And that's what I used to find this electric field outside. I said this is area times E here, area times E here, and what is inside is inside. I calculated that, okay? Like, think of this way. If you have like a single surface, I don't know, it's of course like this. We know it is like E here and E here are the same, right? And why should it be asymmetrical? Now I put like a second surface, right? Now E prime here and E prime here are the same, right? And the point is E plus E prime here and E plus E prime here are the same as long as you are outside the surface. It cannot be asymmetrical. The only asymmetry comes from inside the slab. So this part, so if you like electric field is like, if you plot the electric field, let's plot the electric field as a function of position from here. So, okay, let's do this. We know it's constant here, right? Constant here, constant here. And we found what? We found here, it is like if x is equal to 0, it is like there's something like that. Maybe there's like jump. Something like this. If we are able to simplify this any further or not, since the question does not contain x, I mean, is it okay to leave it like this or not? I think it is okay because the question is saying that, yes. I mean, the question it does not give x, but the question does not give radius here either, right? What is r here? we introduce ourselves. I mean, it's okay.